Hi folks, Melvin here from OptoProductions.com, and I'm here with another Waldorf Blofeld tutorial. In this video, I'm gonna cover the effects section and the arpeggiator, which is actually pretty advanced. So, let's have a closer look. Alright, so last time I spoke about the modulation section, and we had a look at the envelopes, the LFO and the matrix. So now we're gonna move on to the effects. So if you press the shift button, you need to scroll a bit until we end up at effect 1. The Blofeld has two effect sections, and they share a lot of effects. The only difference is that the reverb and delay are only accessible on effect number 2. Okay, so on page 1, we can scroll through all the different effects. We got a chorus, flanger, phaser, overdrive, and a triple effect, which combines three effects into one. And if you take a look at the page numbers, you can see the settings will change depending on which effect you have selected. Okay, so let's start with the chorus. Firstly, on page 1, you usually get a mix control. And chorus is great for bass lines, but also for pads to widen the sound. It makes a copy of the sound and then detunes it a bit. So we got a speed. And a depth. Right, the next effect is a flanger, so similar to a chorus, but with a shorter time base. So we've got a speed and a depth as well, and on the third page we've got a feedback, which can get really loud, so be careful. And you can choose either a negative polarity or a positive. So another classic effect, which also works great on bass lines, okay, so next the phaser, and this works by applying different all-pass filters and modulating the frequency. And you can change the offset on page 3. So this is like the center of the frequency range. So we can move it up. So it hovers around higher frequencies. Or we can lower it. And you can also adjust the spacing between each filter. And here we've also got feedback. I sometimes use this effect on pads. If you set it really slowly, with a little bit of depth, really hear the effect of the filters. Maybe a bit less feedback. So another cool effect to try out. Next we've got a distortion, and here we can choose the same distortion types as on the filters, as I've explained in a previous video. We even got a cutoff here as well. Page 3, we've got a post gain. And it's useful because distortion usually makes things louder. And there's a built-in low pass filter, which is really useful. Most of the times I just use the clipping distortion type just to get some loudness, because some of the presets can be a bit soft. Okay, and finally we've got the triple effects, and here we've got an overdrive and a sample and hold. So like a bit crusher. On the next patch we've got a chorus and a speed. And finally a depth. And the mix is just a dry wet knob for the entire chain. But that's it for the effects on effect slot number one. Then when we move on to effect number two, we've got the same effects with the same settings, but with the addition of a delay, a clocked delay, and a reverb. So let's have a look at the delay first. So we've got a delay length, which is the delay time. A spread, and then we can pan the delays. So at zero it's mono. We've got a feedback and a polarity. So that's the phase. And finally, a low pass filter. Okay, next we've got a clocked delay, so we can synchronize the tempo to an external sequencer or DAW. So here we can change the length in note values. But if you want to make it follow the tempo of your DAW, you need to hold shift and press the global button. And here we've got the global settings, and if you scroll on to the MIDI settings, on page 2 we can see the clock. So you can set this to internal or to auto. If I press play on my keystep, and there it is. Takes a second to clock. If I increase the speed, you will hear some artifacts, so give it some time. Here we can change the note value and spread, and all the other settings are the same to the regular delay, and we can increase the speed up to 1/96th or slow it down to 10 bars. And then finally we've got the reverb effect. We got a high pass filter to get rid of the low end, which is always a smart thing to do to prevent muddiness, or we can get rid of the high end. On the next page we've got a diffusion control. So with this set to zero, we can hear the individual delays. So this controls the reflectivity of the room. We've got a room or reverb size. With a really short size you can really hear the delays, but we can also change the shape, so the shape of the room. And finally we've got a decay and a damping. But if you set the damping really low, can clip a little bit, so I'll just reduce the output level of the amplifier, otherwise it will clip internally. But yeah, that's it for the reverb. It isn't the best sounding reverb I've ever heard, so most of the time I usually use another effect pedal or a plugin, but it's there if you need it. But that wraps it up for the effects. So now I want to take a look at the arpeggiator. Okay, so on page one of the arpeggiator, we can select a different mode. So off, on, one shot, or hold. So let's start with on. So now if I hold down a note on my keyboard, or play a chord, it will arpeggiate the sound. On the next page, I can change the tempo. But as soon as I send it a clock signal, this external clock will take over. We can also access a range of patterns. So with different rhythms. On the next page we can change the direction and the octaves. So we've got up, down, alternating up and down. We can change the gate length of the note. Then I need to turn up the sustain. So we can hear this. And we can also change the order of the arpeggio. So right now it's set to S played. So if I play a low note first and then a high note. Or the other way around, if I start on a high note. But we can also set it to reversed. Or key. So from low notes to high notes, the other way around, or by the velocity. Okay, then we've got a timing factor. So just a swing control. And the velocity, so we can decide if the velocity of what I'm playing is sent through to the arpeggiator. So when it's set to each note, the velocity of each played note is carried through. But if we change this to first note, if I play the first note really loud, this will set the velocity for all the steps. Or we can set it to the last note. And we can even set it to a fixed velocity. And finally, we can change the pattern length. But this works in conjunction with the next page. Because here we've got an actual step sequencer. So let's say I set the length to 4. You can see it's now reduced to 4 steps. And now I need to scroll back and set the pattern to user. So this sequencer will control the rhythm. So I can change position of each step right here. And here we can turn it off, for example. We can set it to the previous step. So let's say I play a 4-note chord. And to make it easier to hear, I'm going to change the order to from low to high. The fourth step will be the same as the step before. So if I'm playing a A, C, E, and G, the fourth step will play the E again. We can also change it to the first step. So on the fourth position, it will play the first note. Or the last. We can also select first and last. So if I play A, C, E, and G again. On the fourth position, it will play the first and the last note. So A and G together. So this is actually a really powerful feature. Okay, we've got two more options. A chord mode. So it will play the entire chord. So if I set position 1 to chord mode and I change the pattern length to 1. Now I've got a chord arpeggiator. That's a cool feature. And finally, we've got a random option. So it will choose a random step. All right. We've actually got a few more options. If we move one page back, we can choose to reset the pattern on each play. With pattern reset off, if I play a note, it will continue playing. But if we turn on pattern reset, it will always play the two notes first and then the pause. So. Okay, let's scroll to the next pages. So we can change the step mode, but we can also add an accent. So like on a 303 sequencer. So this is basically controlling the velocity. On the next page, we can enable glide. So let's turn it on for step 1. Yeah, so let's scroll to the glide options. Probably the rate is set really low. Yeah, that's it. Okay, one page to the right, we can change the timing. So as you can see on the screen, we can move a note to the left or to the right. So similar to how swing works. Okay, I've just connected a RDE6 with a hi-hat playing, so it's easier to hear. But even though I've already changed the timing, nothing is happening yet, because we need to go back and we need to adjust the timing factor. So this is like a dry-wet control, and when this is set to 0, nothing happens. So if I set this to the maximum value and go back to timing, now we should be able to hear it. We can even set it to random. And lastly, we've got the length settings, so we can adjust the length per step. So we can shorten it, or lengthen it, or we can activate the legato if we move all the way to the left. Oh, and by the way, I forgot to mention, on the first page of the arpeggiator, we can turn the arpeggiator off, on, or we can enable one-shot mode. So it plays only once. So that could be useful for certain effects or drum patterns, but I'll get to that in future videos. And the other mode we've got is hold. So you just press a chord once, let go of your keys, and it will keep on playing. Oh, and if you stop the clock, the blowfeld will just keep on playing. So you just need to go back and disable hold mode. Alright, that's it. I think we've covered the entire blowfeld by now. So we went through the oscillators, the filters, the modulation section, and finally the effects and the arpeggiator. The only thing I haven't covered yet is the multi-timbre settings, but I'll probably get back to that in a future video. For now, let me know if you have any questions, and I'll see you soon with some more practical patch examples.